गुणातीतमानं चिदानन्दरूपं चिदाभासकं सर्वगं ध्यानगम्यं गुणातीतमानं चिदानन्दरूपं चिदाभासकं सर्वगं ध्यानगम्यं मुनिर्ध्येयमाकाशरूपं परेशं परब्रह्मरूपं गणेशं भजेम परब्रह्मरूपं गणेशं भजेम परब्रह्मरूपं गणेशं भजेम। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। नमस्ते। वेलकम टू सेशन 50 ऑफ भगवद्गीता वर्स बाय वर्स। टुडे वी आर एंटरिंग द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ चैप्टर 7 एंड स्टडी निष्काम भक्ति। डॉक्टर मीनल केकतपुरी, श्रीमती सुकन्या नारायण, डॉक्टर श्रीनिवासराव नूटी, श्रीमती इंदुमति बेल्लावे एंड डॉक्टर आशा नायक विल टेल अस ऑल अबाउट दिस भक्ति बिरेफ्ट ऑफ एनी संकल्प। डॉक्टर हेगडे सर विल एज यूजुअल सप्लीमेंट दिस टॉक्स विद हिज एडिशनल पॉइंट्स। कुमारी श्रीनिधि will chant verses 7.26 to 7.30 after the presentations. But now, let's go to Dr. Rekha Kumar, who will give us a brief recap of Sakama Bhakti in verses 7.18 to 7.25, which we studied last session. Over to you, Dr. Rekha.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. A quick recap as to the topics already covered in Chapter 7, Jnana Vijnana Yoga. In the first three verses, Lord Krishna mentions that he is going to give Arjuna information about the nature of God in the form of the lower saguna formed Ishvara, that is Jnanam, and Vijnanam, which is knowledge of the higher formless Ishvara. He also mentions that the glory of this knowledge is that one gets both emotional and intellectual fulfillment. From the fourth to the 12th verse, Lord Krishna discusses Ishvara Swarupam. This principle consists of two factors, para prakriti, consciousness, and apara prakriti, the matter principle. In the 13th verse, Lord Krishna deals with the cause of human misery or samsara, which is due to dependence on apara prakriti for peace, security, and happiness, and failing to get it. The cure, Lord Krishna says, is bhakti, which is a series of sadhanas which culminate in jnanam, which implies sharanagati or surrendering to Lord Krishna. And this is in verses 14 to 19. In verses 20 to 26, Lord Krishna deals with Sakama Bhakti, a form of worship through which we seek apara prakriti benefits, which have both plus and minus points. Next slide, please. Quickly going through verses 14 to 19 in more detail, we learned that jnanam through bhakti is the only parihara for samsara. Krishna then describes the non-bhaktas, those who have enough punya to be born in the human form, but not enough to come to Shastra. He then classifies bhaktas into four types, Chaturvidha. The Artha, one who seeks the Lord only in crisis, the Artharthi, the seeker of material gains, the Jignasu Bhakta, the seeker of knowledge, but God is his goal, and the Jnani Bhakta, the wise one who sees God as himself. Lord Krishna then heaps praise on the Jnani Bhakta, saying he is not a samsari, he is the greatest. The verses 17, 18 and 19 are goalpost verses where Lord Krishna reveals his true self once again. Verse 18 in the next slide is a Mahavakya Shloka, where the Aikyam between the Jnani and Bhagwan is revealed. Here Lord Krishna answers the question whether the non-Jnani Bhaktas are not dear to him. He says, reassuringly, that all devotees are noble and dear to him, but the wise man is me, myself, because with a steadfast mind, he has resorted to Krishna alone, who is the highest goal. In verse 19, next slide, we learn that attaining the highest level of bhakti is not easy. It needs time and maturity. Lord Krishna says, at the end of many births, bahunam janmanam, one comes to me, mam prapadyate, as a wise man, with the wisdom that Vasudeva is everything. Here Vasudeva represents Satrupa Ishvara, and Chidrupa Brahman, the Lord in the form of conscious existence. Lord Krishna says such a noble soul is very rare. Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. In verse 20, Lord Krishna begins a new topic where he classifies bhaktas into two, the Sakama and Nishkama bhaktas. In this verse, Lord Krishna criticizes the Sakama bhaktas as those who are deprived of discrimination, hrita nanaha, because they have finite goals due to the intense raga dvesha because of their prarabdha, and they follow that in their worship of other deities, anya devata. In the next slide, in verses 21 and 22, Lord Krishna offers a ray of hope when he gives the plus points of Sakama Bhakti. He says, Ishvara will take care that all our goals are fulfilled, and in so doing, our faith in whichever deity we worship will be strengthened. Aham achalam vidadhami. But the Sakama Bhaktas don't recognize that it is actually Ishvara and not the Ishta Devata who is fulfilling their wishes. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna represents Para Prakriti, the consciousness non-dual principle. In verse 22, Lord Krishna reiterates the same. Endowed, yuktaha, with that faith, Shraddha, the Bhakta engages in worship of that form, and from that he attains, Labhate, all those desires which are indeed granted by me alone. Mai eva vihitan kaman. In effect, Lord Krishna is saying, all prayers come to me and all blessings come from me. The negative aspect of Sakama Bhakti is given in verse 33. 23. Lord Krishna says, Sakama Bhakti is wonderful and you can fulfill all your desires, but, big but, there is a statutory warning. Every gain you get is finite and has three inherent doshas, which are BAD, bad. This is an acronym for Bandhakatvam, addiction to what we have, Atripti Karatvam, dissatisfaction and wanting more, and Dukkha Mishritatvam, admixture with sorrow because of possible loss and maintenance. There is spiritual stagnation and samsara will continue. A strong word, Alpa Medasam, is used for such bhaktas. Verse 24 continues the same theme. Lord Krishna says, ignorant people take the physical body to be the real God. They are foolish, a buddhaya, and have a misconception about me. And what is the glory about the higher me? Krishna says, I am avyayam, I am changeless. I am anuttamam, unsurpassed, the highest. I do not appear and disappear. In the next verse, verse 25, we learn the answer to the question of, if consciousness is ever present, how do most people miss it? Lord Krishna says, I am not evident to all because I am veiled by yoga maya. Maya refers to the three gunas here and it belongs to apara prakriti. The nature of apara prakriti is attractive and we get deluded and our thinking becomes clouded. Lord Krishna says, being deluded, muda, the world does not know me, who am birthless, ajam, and deathless, avyaya. This is when the guru helps us by pointing out that whatever we seek is within ourselves. Thank you. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Rekha. That was an excellent summary of not only last class, but also a glimpse of the essence of the entire wonderful seventh chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Sadashiva samarambham Shankaracharya madhyamam Asmadacharya pariyantam Vande Guru Paramparam. Om. We are extremely fortunate that we have been able to make a verse-to-verse study of one more chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. And today we come to the concluding part of this most wonderful seventh chapter, which begins in a very unique manner, where Krishna promises that he will introduce himself to us. And for those of us who make a certain amount of effort, he says, you can now know me completely. The words he uses are jnanam and vijnanam, which means two kinds of knowledge. One is called para and the other is called apara. it is extremely rare, Sri Krishna says, to find someone who's striving to know God. And let us be one of those few people that Sri Krishna is referring to. He says, one in a thousand attempts to know me. And among them, one in a thousand is successful. It means one in a million becomes successful. Now we need to see ourselves as one in a million. That is why Sri Krishna and all our teachers again and again reiterate, unless we have that positive attitude that I am here to succeed, I am here for extraordinary accomplishment, outstanding accomplishment like this, Brahma Vidya, is not going to be easy. In the important fifth verse, Sri Krishna declares the two aspects, what is called the apara, the world that we can experience, and he introduces us to himself as the consciousness through which we are able to experience this whole world. And this is exactly as a verse that we will be studying in the 13th chapter, where Sri Krishna more directly says the same thing. Kshetrajnam chapi mam viddhi sarva kshetreshu bharata. That means kshetrajna, the one who is aware of this field. Please remember, please know, viddhi, not only in me, Sri Krishna says, but in everyone. It is the same Sri Krishna principle. That means we need to claim that the higher awareness principle is none other than a manifestation of Sri Krishna in all of us. What Sri Krishna is doing in the fifth verse of the seventh chapter, the third verse of the 13th chapter, Sri Krishna is introducing a very fundamental Vedantic methodology called Drik Drishya Viveka. At all the time, we need to be aware of Drik Drishya Viveka. Whatever I see and experience is apara. The one who sees is para. Our teacher reminds us again and again of two fundamental laws of Vedanta. And he says, if these two fundamental laws are understood, Vedanta becomes easy. If these are not understood, Vedanta becomes a problem. The first fundamental principle is I am other than whatever I experience. I am the drip and whatever I see is drishyam. The drishyam is of a lower order of reality compared to the drik. Second is whatever attributes that I can see belong to the object of experience. I, the real I, have no attributes. If this alone is understood, it is very liberating because it means the real me, the consciousness in me, and I need to disidentify with the, from the body-mind complex and identify with the higher me. The real me has no gunas. I have no limitations in time, no limitations in space, no limitations with regard to this object. Once that is understood, once we have made a kshetra-kshetrajna difference, I need to be able to see godliness in the world around me. Even though I said this is kshetram, it is a lower order, it is none other than the body of the Lord itself. And therefore, if I'm able to see the Lord imperceptibly in and through, in these famous verses like Mattaha Parataram Nanyat, Rasoham Apsu Kaunteya, and so on. Krishna gradually takes a very gentle shift. If everything I see and experience is God and godliness, why is there so much suffering in the world? And then he brings an idea to the veiling power of Maya. Although it is godliness, it is God in manifest form, there is an obstacle between me and whatever I see and experience. And this obstacle is so powerful that the only solution, Sri Krishna says, is through bhakti. Having introduced bhakti, he says there are four types of bhakti, as was just spoken by Dr. Rekha. And then he brings us to the jnani bhakti, verses 17, 18, and 19 in the seventh chapter. Remember these verses, 17, 18, and 19. Are called goal post verses. They are the sthita prajna portion. they are the verses that we need to study so thoroughly, because that will help us to identify with what I really want in my life. Can I become a parabhakta? Can I become a sthita prajna? Can I become a jnani? Can I become the highest of all bhaktas? And when you are that, then there is no difference between Bhagwan and the bhakta. Shri Krishna says, this is the highest accomplishment anybody can happen. Anybody, it can happen to anyone. And such a person, he brings a nice word called Vasudeva Sarvam. He is able to see the whole world, the world of existence, as Shri Krishna, Vasate, the first part of Vasudeva, and Deva, the consciousness within me, as the consciousness principle. That means Shri Krishna is introducing to whatever I experience is existence, and the experiencer within me is consciousness. In today's class, in the last verse, which will be told to us by Dr. Asha Naik, very strong message is given to us. For a person who is able to see godliness in and through everything, such a person will be able to see God even at the time of death. That means you will remember me at the time of death. And this becomes a seed for the next chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Having studied the seventh chapter, I am reminded so much of the Mundaka Upanishad. The Mundaka Upanishad is seen again and again in the seventh chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, because we know all along, Sarvo Upanishado Gavu Dogda Gopala Nandana. Shri Krishna has brought out the essence of all the Upanishads in the Bhagavad Gita. Just like in the third verse, Shri Krishna says, Manushyanam Sahasreshu, the Mundaka Upanishad begins in a very brilliant manner, saying that Brahmaji himself imparted this Vidya to the eldest son, and he traces it down to the guru of the Mundaka Upanishad. Shri Krishna begins the second verse by saying, if you know my true nature, there is nothing else worth knowing in this world. The Mundaka Upanishad begins with a bang, where the student says, O Bhagavan, O my teacher, can you tell me that knowledge, knowing which everything worth knowing is known? It is a very similar, again, the main question of Mundaka Upanishad is brought out again by Shri Krishna here. And the answer, the teacher says, remember, all knowledge is of two types. One is apara, the objective world. Second is para. He brings in drik drishya viveka, or the fundamental laws of Vedanta. As we study the Mundaka Upanishad, you will see certain verses which will give you, once these verses like Purusha Evam Vishvam Karma Tapo, these sort of verses are explained to us by an Acharya, it gives you such immense joy. You know, what is this joy of Vidyananda? Vidyananda is the joy of spiritual wisdom. And you will see this wisdom is equivalent to Atma Vidya. The Mundaka Upanishad is, this verse which I said is very similar to Mattaha Parataram Nanyat Kinchidanti Dhananjaya, where the teacher says, oh my dear student, anyone who knows that Purusha who's seated in the cave of one's heart, if you are able to discover that, then all your ignorance is gone and you discover the truth in this life itself. Then there are more beautiful verses like Vidyate Hridaya Granthi and Na Tatra Suryo Bhati Na Chandra Tarakam, where we have the counterparts of each of them in the seventh chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. I'm reminded of another Upanishad called the Taittri Upanishad, which begins the second chapter, which is called Brahmananda Valli, which begins in a very amazing manner, which says, Brahma Vid Apnoti Param. That means, the knower of Brahman attains the supreme. He attains the Parabhakta state that this verses 17, 18, and 19 described. Now, why am I saying all this? As students of the Gita, we are given an insight into the Upanishads. But as if we make a commitment that we will study the Upanishads, the next question is, how many Upanishads should I study? There are so many, there are at least 108 Upanishads. When Bhagavan Ramana was asked this question, he replied, to see yourself, how many mirrors do you require? One Upanishad properly studied, one Mundaka Upanishad if you're able to study thoroughly. And this is my commitment to each one of us who are part of this course, that in between the chapters, like we are doing Dakshinamurti Stotra, Upadesha Sara, once these texts are over, they'll bring in Mundaka Upanishad verse by verse. And by the time we finish the 18th chapter, the entire Mundaka Upanishad verse by verse will also be completed. This is a very famous book by Stephen Covey called First Things First, where he brings a new concept of time management. Based on this philosophy, the things that matter the most should not be at the mercy of things that matter the least. While I've got this birth of a being, a human being, if I'm able to get that knowledge, which matters the most, and if I'm able to focus on that which matters the most, then my whole priority in life will change. I will reorient my whole life to what really matters. When I give a greater commitment. See, our motivation and commitment depends on what we value. If you value Brahma Vidya, then we will schedule our whole life so that I will be able to invest on this. So otherwise, what is not important becomes important, and what is important becomes unimportant, and we lose sight of what is truly important. So let us have a refocusing on how important Brahma Vidya is in our lives. With this background, we begin this class. Our opening verse, verse 76, will be explained to us by Dr. Meenal. Over to you, Dr. Meenal.
Namaste. From the 20th verse till the 26th verse of the 7th chapter, Lord Krishna is dealing with the topic of Sakama Bhakti. Sakama Bhakti is the worship through which a person seeks materialistic goals, that is, everything other than God, everything that is finite. Sakama Bhakti will give phalam, but only a finite one, and that too only for a limited time, which is eventually bound to bring pain and suffering by keeping a person bound to samsara. If only Sakama Bhakti is practiced, then a person will not grow spiritually beyond a certain stage. Sakama Bhakti is the only means to arrive at Nishkama Bhakti. And Nishkama Bhakti is impossible without Sakama Bhakti. Also, Sakama Bhakti is incomplete without coming to Nishkama Bhakti. Sakama Bhakti will give finite and impermanent phalam only. So, what is that infinite goal which is free from all these limitations and that we must all strive for? That infinite goal is nothing but para prakruti, my own higher nature, which is the true source of ananda, the ultimate source of peace, security, and permanence, which is already within me. Para prakruti is none other than Sakshi Chaitanyam, the consciousness principle which pervades everything in this creation. A Nishkama Bhakta will eventually obtain oneness with this very consciousness principle, and then Maya will not be able to delude such a Jnani. If everything is within me, then why do I look outside? Because of ignorance, which is brought on by Maya, the deluding potency. With this background, let us read the 26th verse of chapter 7. Vedaham samati tani वर्तमानानि चार्जुन भविष्याणि च भूतानि माम तु वेदन कश्चन. In the previous verse, Krishna said that the whole world, that is the entire humanity, is deluded by Maya. That is why Maya is called as the Mohini or the deluder. So if Maya is deluding everyone, then will not the same Maya or Apara Prakruti delude the Lord also? In this verse, Krishna explains that this is not the case. God is the master of Maya. Next slide, please, sir. While Jiva is a slave, God is the controller of Maya, while Jivas are controlled by Maya, and hence they get deluded. Maya casts a veil on the reality, which is nothing but Brahman or the Sakshi Chaitanya pervading everything. In this verse, Krishna says, Aham Veda, I know, because I do not have the problem of ignorance. I know both the para prakruti as well as the apara prakruti intimately. What does Krishna know? Bhutani, all the beings, the entire creation is very well known to him, as he is not limited by Maya. Samititani, the past, Vartamanani, the present, and Bhavishyani, the future. All the three words here are used as an adjective of Bhutani. That is Samatitani Bhutani, Vartamanani Bhutani, and Bhavishyani Bhutani. The past beings, present beings, and the future beings. In short, the entire creation from the beginning to the end is known to God. Kashchana Mamna Veda, Krishna says, I know everything, whereas the Jiva does not know me, especially my para prakruti. It is to be noted that Kashchan here refers to a Jiva. The Jiva does not know para prakruti because Jiva has a problem of ignorance. Jiva is a Alpadnya, while God is a Sarvadnya. It is because of this very ignorance that the Jiva suffers from samsara and remains caught in the cycle of death and birth. This verse can be translated as, O Arjuna, I know of the past, present, and future, and I also know all the living beings, but me, no one knows. The gist of this verse is that Ishvara is Sarvadnya, as he is the master controller of Maya, which has no effect on him. But a Jiva who is steeped in samsara is deluded by Maya and fails to realize his own true nature, his own higher nature, and therefore perpetually remains ignorant and caught in the cycle of birth and death. From the next verse, number 27, up to the verse number 30, Krishna talks about Nishkama Bhakti. Thank you very much. Hari Om.
Thank you very much, Dr. Meenal, for a very nice explanation of this verse. This verse comes from the context where Sri Krishna has been explaining. If God and godliness is everywhere, how is that I'm not able to experience? And Sri Krishna brings about the power of Maya. The question comes, now, will Sri Krishna be affected by Maya? And as nicely explained by Dr. Meenal, the Lord replies, I am unaffected. And what it means to all of us is, the more we have Brahma Vidya, I know that I have a potential to be affected. But then I can go beyond this film of Maya by my commitment to Brahma Vidya. Now I know that whatever I am seeing is Brahman, and I am also Brahman. The next and an important verse, you will see a new shift in the whole teaching comes. We are shifting to Nishkama, and that will be explained to us by Sukanya. Over to you, Sukanya.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. We are in the concluding verses of this chapter of Yoga of Knowledge and Realization. Verses till now explain why humans go through the sorrow of ocean of samsara. It's because of ignorance, lack of knowledge of para prakriti. Humanity misses recognizing the higher form of God in and through our life. Krishna suggests seeking Ishvara Anugraha and total surrender to cross over this ocean. This verse explains the definition of samsara, patta. Ichha dvesha samuttena dvandva mohena bharata sarva bhutani sammoham sarge yanti parantapa. Krishna addresses Arjuna here as Bharata, one born in the family of Bharata, and also as Parantapa, one who destroys enemies. Ischa dvesha samuttena, a product of likes and dislikes. Dvandva mohena, delusion. Sarva bhutani sammoham, all beings are deluded. Sarge yanti, at the time of birth itself. O Arjuna, due to delusion of reality caused by desire and hatred, all beings are deluded right from the time of birth itself. Delusion is a universal problem, an adi beginningless. That's why it's called sarge by default from the time of birth itself. What is delusion? Not capable of understanding the true nature, or even when understood, the human intelligence gets wrapped in raga dvesha due to maya shakti. That's avarna shakti, concealment, and vikshepa shakti, wrong understanding of maya, which is also beginningless. Next minute, sir. Sarva bhutani sammoham. All beings are deluded due to pair of opposites like sukha dukkha, pain and pleasure. This verse deals with raga dvesha. I like it, I hate it, which is a thought process in the mind leading to either happiness or sorrow. So our life revolves around making efforts to change situations, people, objects favorable to us, thinking it will solve the problem. But this is only a temporary phase. Raga dvesha overpowers human intellect and also obstructs use of free will. It's a product of rajoguna. Kama esha krodha esha rajoguna samudbhava. It propels a person to do varied actions for attaining material accomplishment. Raga is also associated with fear. Vita raga bhaya krodha manmaya mam upasita. Duality is the cause of samsara, attachment towards some and aversion towards some, constantly running after or running away from situations. Swami Paramarthananda ji calls it AADD, attraction, aversion, dualistic illusion. Next slide. This duality of raga, dvesha is universal, but the objects of attachment are different in different stages of human life. This is explained in a verse in Bhagavad Govinda. Balastavat krida sattaha. Childhood revolves around playing with toys. After a few years, this interest fades away. Tarunastavat tarani sattaha. Youth is lost in being attracted towards the opposite sex. Vriddhastavat chinta sattaha. Old age is lost in worrying about everything. Parame brahmani kopi asattaha. No one has time for inward journey of because of food, possessions, obligations, responsibilities, and transactions in worldly life. Swami Dayananda Saraswati says, ignorance afflicts humans at birth itself, like the Tamburi Shruti in music. Next slide, sir. World is a mixture of sat and asat. We experience both, but we get too involved in asat, we lose sight of the satrapancha, that's existence and consciousness, in and through our lives. In fact, world is neither a cause of happiness nor a cause of sorrow. Cause of happiness is the knowledge of higher self, and cause of sorrow is not knowing myself. Jeevas born and continuing with the grip of raga dvesha due to maya shakti cannot absorb spiritual knowledge. They continue to be in the triangular format and cannot enter the binary format. Relying on the world for peace, security, and happiness is impermanent. A self-controlled mind enjoys tranquility and is free from likes and dislikes. Raga dvesha viyuktesu vishayan indriyacharan atmavarshe vidheyatma prasadam adigacchati. Next letter. A simple solution that Krishna suggests is nishkama bhakti, desireless, unconditional devotion, knowing the higher nature of God para prakriti as revealed in the Shastra through Sravana, Manana, under the guidance of a competent guru. With such nishkama bhakti, one overcomes the fear by letting go of the ego and reality by merging into the supreme consciousness. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sukanya. That was a very nice explanation of a very important verse where the Lord tells us how we get deluded right from the beginning. Now, this is my own understanding of this verse, and I want you to understand at which moment does this delusion happen. The moment our mind is born. And when is the mind born? The moment we wake up. The moment we wake up, we begin to see this world through our mind. And because we are able to see the world through the mind makes a seeming separation between the world as not me and this as me. And this is the whole problem. And therefore, that moment when we wake up, we need to realize that although I have a very functioning mind which helps me to interact, this mind tends to give me a false idea of a limited me. Once I know that I am limited, then all my efforts will be for Purnatvam. But the more I realize I'm already that, and this world which is not apart from me is only an extension of me. And through Brahma Vidya, if I'm able to see this, we are those fortunate people. The next verse will be explained to us by Dr. Srinivas Nuthi. Over to you, Dr. Srinivas.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The verse is like this. Esham twantagatam papam jananam punyakarmanam te vandva mohena nirmukta bhajante mam drudavrataha. This is the verse. Let us see the meaning of each word. Esham means whoever. So next word is twantagatam. This word can be split into tu plus antagatam. Antagatam can again be split into antam gatam. This is a samasa here. Dvitiya tatpurusha samasa, that is called. So here meaning of tu is, tu means on the other hand or but, like that. So this verse here, on the other hand, why he is telling on the other hand is, in the previous verse, Sage Vyasa has mentioned that whole world, the people all over the world, sarva bhutani sammoham sarge yanti. So all the people are deluded by the duality. So then who are the ones who are not deluded by the duality? That's why he's using the word tu here. So those people who are not deluded. So on the other hand, or but, that is the meaning of tu. Antam gatam. Antam means end. Gatam means going to end. Or simply the meaning is ended. So next is the very important word, papam. What is meant by papam? So this is in English, because of there is no good alternative, so the word sin is used to indicate papam. But in Sanskrit or in Vedantic term, when we use the word papam, the meaning is the regretful mental agitations which we get by doing wrong things, or by things which we have, by good things which we have not done. This is the explanation given by Swami Chinmayananda. So mental agitations which we get by doing the wrong things. So this is meant by papam. This is very important here to understand. I will explain it later. Next words are jananam punyakarmanam. So of those people, jananam means of those people who has done virtuous deeds. Punyakarmanam means virtuous deeds. So the meaning of this sentence is, whoever has ended their sins, for those good people, by doing the virtuous deeds. That is the meaning of the first line. Next line, they means these people, or that people, or they. Dvandva moha nirmuktaha means dvandva, duality, moha, this delusion or attachment, nirmuktaha, freed. That means freed from the delusions of duality. Bhajante means it is translated as worship. Or Swami Chinmayananda also translates it as meditate. Mam means nannannu, so or me. Dhrudavrataha, or you can call it as a firm conviction or a firm mind. So the previous slide, sir. So whoever has ended their sins by doing virtuous deeds, they being freed by the delusions of the duality, with a firm convicted mind, they meditate on me. This is the meaning of the whole verse. Let us see the Shankara Bhashyam, what Acharya Shankaracharya has mentioned about this word papam. So here the issue problem comes. Nowadays we see that many people think that they can initially do wrong deeds, and that will get neutralized by doing the good deeds, by either going to temples, or by doing good deeds, by donating, or by donating, or by helping in the any ashramas or ruddhashramas or all these things. So that is the problem. So nowadays, this is what is happening. We can see that there is no temple is empty, and everybody makes God a partner in their business, and they will give some whatever percentage. So what is Adi Shankaracharya has mentioned is, see the highlighted word, sattva shuddhi karanam. So that can be translated as, so good deeds causing purity of mind. So those people of good deeds, that is good deeds causing purity of mind, whose sin has almost come to an end or freed from the delusions of the pairs. This is what Shankaracharya has mentioned. So we know that whenever we do a egocentric work, any karma or any work which we do, that leads to, one is karma phalam, and another is mental impressions, which are called as vasanas. So if you do a good deeds, punya karma, it gives rise to punya karma phalam as well as punya vasanas. And if you do a papa karma, it gives rise to papa vasanas as well as papa karmas. So we cannot escape. The point here is we cannot escape from these karma phalas. But the vasanas which we get by doing punya karmas will replace the vasanas which we have accumulated by doing the papa karmas. But we cannot escape from the karma phala. If you have done bad works, we have to face the music. Similarly, if we do good works, and we have to enjoy the fruits of that good deeds. So whether we do good deeds or bad deeds, the whatever results, we need to face it. But by doing good deeds, we will be only able to eliminate the bad vasanas. So once these vasanas are eliminated, the mind becomes free. And then the mind becomes eligible to meditate on the Lord. So that's the reason why the Lord has earlier mentioned that we have to do karma in the form of karma yoga. That is in the form of Ishwara Arpana Bhavam and Karma Falatyagam. So this is very important to understand. Otherwise, because of this non-understanding of these kind of verses, you see a lot of rush in the temples and expecting that their good deeds will neutralize the bad deeds. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. Let us consider ourselves as those fortunate ones. Otherwise, if not for the blessings, we will not be able to come to this understanding of the Bhagavad Gita. And let us have, as Dr. Srinivas said, indulge in good deeds which bring us Shubha Vasanas and which perpetuate a positive mental frame of mind. Again, the topic now shifts because Krishna very imperceptibly now takes us to the next chapter, which will be explained to us by Indumati. Over to you, Indumati.
Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Lord Krishna in the previous verse has said, those men of virtuous deeds whose sins have come to an end, who are freed from the delusion of the pace of opposites and steadfast in vows, worship me. Then what would be the motive in the heart of those who are thus meditating upon the self after their minds have been readjusted by living the life divine? Mam bhajante, they begin to seek me, the para prakriti, seeking the infinite, which is called the nishkama bhakti. The verse goes like this: jara marana mokshaya मामाश्रित्ययतन्तिये ते ब्रह्मतद्विदुकृत्स्नम् अध्यात्मम् कर्मचाकिलम्. The word by word meaning goes like this: आश्रित्य माम, having resorted to me, ते ये यतन्ति, those who strive जरामरण मोक्षाय, for freedom from decay and death, ते विदुहु, they know the Lord, Tat Brahma, that Brahman, Kritsnam, completely, Adhyatma, the self completely, Cha, Karma Akhilam, and Karma also completely. Those who strive for liberation from old age and death, taking refuge in me, they realize in full that Brahman, the whole knowledge of the self and all action, that is Karma, completely. In the next slide, Lord Krishna says, when the papam ends, dvandva moha nirmuktaha bhavati, they are no more deluded. They have now got nitya anitya vastu vivekaha. Therefore, they have got iha mutraha phalabhoga vairagyam, and they have diagnosed the problem of life. What do they do now? Nishkama bhaktas are interested in going beyond time. Jara means old age, maranam means death. Both are caused by kala or time. In the next slide, kalo jagat bhakshakaha. Therefore, going beyond jara and maranam is going beyond time. And the only thing beyond time is para prakriti, which is the source of immortality, security, peace and happiness. Therefore, moksha means discovery of para prakriti, and those who use bhakti for this discovery are called nishkama bhaktas. They will understand both saguna ishvara and nirguna ishvara, both matter and spirit, ubhayorapi drishtum taha stvanayos tattva darshibhi. In the next slide, when does nishkama bhakti begin then? It is when I know that the world is neither the cause of sorrow nor the cause of happiness, and I know that I am the cause of both sorrow and happiness. When I have got a wrong understanding about myself, that is, the misunderstood I is the cause of sorrow. Rightly understood I is the cause of happiness. Like when a rope is understood and seen as a rope, it is not the cause of fear. But when the same rope is misunderstood as a snake, it frightens. Similarly, when I am misunderstood, I become the cause of sorrow. When I know myself, I am the cause of happiness. In the next slide, once I have the clarity to know myself, Jignasu Bhakti begins. Lord Krishna says, Jara Amarana Mokshaya, freedom from samsara, consisting of many problems, the most frightening problems being old age and death. So, the seekers of moksha, ye yanti mam ashritya, that is, they take shelter in me, seeking my grace. Such people are tadviduhu. This means they know both apara prakriti as well as the para prakriti of the Lord. They know the saguna ishvara and nirguna ishvara as also. In fact, they know the Lord in totality, te viduhu. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Indumati, for a nice explanation of the 29th verse, where Shri Krishna plays a small trick. Initially, he said, I will introduce me completely. You need to know my higher and lower nature. And instead of saying that if you become a Parabhakta, you will know me completely, he uses certain technical terms like Brahma, Karma, Adhyatma, and so on. That confusion will continue in the next verse, which will be explained to us by Dr. Asha Naik. Over to you, Dr. Asha Naik.
Om Gurubhyo Namaha. Jai Gurudev. Lord Krishna gives introduction firstly by defining God in this Jnana Vijnana Yoga chapter, Ishwara. Ishwara is that principle which consists of two factors known as para and apara prakriti. This principle, which consists of two aspects, features or two anshas, para and apara. In simple English, it is spirit principle and matter principle. Both are beginningless. Conscious is never created or creatable. It is eternal principle. Ishwara alone manifests universe. In technical term, Ishwara Jagata Upadana Karanam. There is no world separate from God, and God is the cause and world is effect. Next slide, sir. Paraprakriti is higher nature. Next, Paraprakriti is higher nature and not subject to time and space, whereas Aparaprakriti is a lower nature and within time and space. Paraprakriti is Brahman, not subject to division or change, and known as Vijnani and Nirguna Swarupam, whereas Aparaprakriti is Maya, subject to division or change, and known as Jnani, Saguna Swarupam. Now, Lord Krishna has used six technical terms like para aparaprakriti is in verse 29 and 30, which are seed verse for 8th chapter, Akshara Brahma Yoga. Akshara means mortality and Akshara means immortality. These six technical words are Brahma, Karma, Adhyatma, Adibhuta, Adideva, and Adiyajna. Next slide, sir. Lord Krishna tells Arjuna what need to be done in the 30th verse for striving freedom from life. But it has been told in such a way that Arjuna is bound to ask many questions. The verse goes like this. Sadibhuta Deivam Maam Sadhi Agnya Chaye Viduhu Prayana Kale Pichamam Te Vidur Yukta Vedasa. Meaning, those with disciplined mind who know me along with Adibhuta, Adideva, Adi Agnya will remember me at the time of death also is very important. Next slide, sir. Let's take word by word meaning. Te yukta chetasa. Te means those. Yukta means wise, disciplined, or ready. Chetasa means mind. E vidu. E means who. Vidu means marati, remembers me or knows me. Mam, that is me. Sa adibhuta. Sa is along. Along adibhuta, adi daiva, adi yajna. Vidu mam, remember me. Prayana kale. Prayana is a, means travel. Travel is end of the life travel. That is marana. Kale is time. Apicha, this is apicha is very important. Means even at the last time, you can remember all the time, but at the time of the last breath also, you should remember. Next line. Adibhutam is an entire perishable word. Adideyam is a total consciousness associated with total subtle mind. That is total knowledge. Adiyagnam, Ishvara, seed form of universe. That is conscious, conscious plus Sakti Maya. Conscious plus Karana Prapancha. In Tattva Bodha, Adideva is Hiranyagarbha. That is Samastha Sukshma Sharira Sahita Chaitanyam. Total conscious plus total subtle mind. It is associated with total knowledge. Adi Yajna Purusha is defined as conscious associated with Karana Prapancha. Conscious principle, this is associated with every action you do. Everything you do. Prayer, puja, even every action you do, even receiving the puja or phalam of puja also is Adi Yajnam. Next slide. Adi Bhutam. Every perishable thing is called Adi Bhutam. Any object you experience is Adi Bhutam. All the five elements, sun, moon, stars, everything like river, mountain, even physical bodies which are perishable. Therefore, entire perishable world is called Adi Bhutam. Next slide. Adi Daivam. Hiranyagarbha, total knowledge, conscious of all subtle bodies. Sukshma Charira is Hiranyagarbha, and Hiranyagarbha is called presiding deity for the every organ. That is example, eyes, Chakshu Surya, Surya Devata. Now, these all presiding deities put together is called Hiranyagarbha. Next slide, sir. Adi Yajna, Lord himself, Ishvara, Karana Prapancha. Whole universe is a potential form other than called Shakti Maya. That Maya plus consciousness is called Ishvara. In next slide. In Puranic symbolism, when Krishna floats over leaf is symbolically told. But all this just, why all these six factors are para and apara prakriti, these six words are used. This wise person are disciplined person will remember me, Prayana Kali, at the time of death also. Why should Krishna specifically mention Ishvara Smarana at Marana for last breath, exact time? Why should you? What is the significance of this? And how to achieve this? How to practice with Abhyasa and Sadhana, which will be explained in the next chapter, Akshara Brahma. Hari Om.
Thank you, madam, for a nice explanation of this verse and also giving us some details, which means there is a lot of preparation that we need to do for the eighth chapter, because unless we know the significance of these technical terms, which comes only by a proper understanding of Tattva Bodha. So Krishna is concluding this chapter by saying that if you know my true nature, you know both the para and the apara. And by now, because you are now a para bhakta, and a para bhakta will remember me all the time, and a person who remembers me all the time will definitely remember me at the time of death also. Our next class will be a re-look at this most important chapter, because unless this chapter is integrated into our mind. So we will have one more class where we will be working on Shri Krishna offering to reveal himself completely and to tell us that there is not just one God, there is only God. Everything that I see. The beautiful verse, Mai Sarvam Idam Protam Sutre Manigana Eva. Remember that word, Vasudeva. Everything that I see is vasate, and the consciousness is here. Shri Krishna also said, even though everything is God, there is so much suffering. And that is because of avidya at my level, maya in the total level. And the solution is bhakti, and not just ordinary bhakti, but a jnani bhakti. Let us become all para bhakta. We will have a chanting by Shri Nidhi of these verses. Over to you, Shri Nidhi.
Vedaham samatitani vartamanani charjuna bhavishyani cha bhutani mam tu vedana kashchana ichha dvesha samuttena dvandva mohena bharata sarva bhutani sammoham sarge yanti parantapa yesham tvantagatam papam jananam punya karmanam te dvantva moha nirmuktaha bhajante mam drudavrata jara marana mokshaya mama shritya yatantiye te brahma tadvidu krishnam adhyatmam karma chakilam sadhi bhutadi daivam mam sadhi yajnam jaye viduhu prayana kale pichamam te vidurayukta chetasah om tat satiti श्रीमद् भगवत गीतासु उपनिषत्सु ब्रह्म विद्यायां योगशास्त्रे श्री कृष्णार्जुन संवादे ज्ञान विज्ञान योगो नाम सप्तमोऽध्यायः हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम.
Thank you, Srinidhi, for your melodious and flawless rendering. Thank you, all speakers, for your nice presentations. And Dr. Hegde, sir, for guiding us through the today's session. Coming Monday, we will have a recap of the entire 7th chapter. As always, please log in by 6:45 p.m. on that day. Until then, Jai Shri Krishna. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om.